Obviously, corporate expectations are very, very different, but nowadays, as a regular old desktop Linux user, it's kind of unthinkable that you would pay for a Linux distro. Now, I know some of you are going to say, well, what about elementary OS? And yes, this is kind of an example, but this is more like a donation built into the download process because you don't have to pay any of the prices listed here. You can set it to zero and download it completely for free. What if I told you there was a time where maybe it wasn't the norm, but there was a developing market of distros you would actually purchase, and not just distros you would purchase that were targeted at corporate users, but distros targeting corporate and also home users, purchased in a way like you would purchase a copy of Windows, which nowadays you don't even see distros try to do. Yes, there are cases like elementary OS, but I mean an actual set price that you paid to get it. And it certainly could be argued that as software got better, as distros got better, as internet speeds got faster and more common, and it was more likely that people actually had a home internet connection that was suitable for downloading multiple gigabytes, maybe this model would have just naturally ended by itself. But I think it's fair to say that one project in particular may have ended the model a lot sooner than it would have naturally ended, with that project being Ubuntu. Now, Ubuntu first dropped in 2004 with the 4.10 release, Warty Warthog. But let's back up just a little bit to the very start of Linux. In the beginning, there was a kernel. And within the very first year of Linux, we started seeing the very earliest foundation, the very earliest formation of some of the early Linux distros. First, we saw MCC Interim Linux. There were some things before that that arguably could be a distro, but MCC Interim Linux is what I generally define as the very first distro. Following this, we had SLS Soft Landing Linux System. And from there, most people tend to skip to Debian and Slackware, both of which were based on Soft Landing Linux System. However, between those two points, there is the often skipped very first commercial Linux distro. Now, when we are talking about a commercial Linux distro from back in the 90s, this is very different from what you would expect today, and the kind of features it was offering are just not what you get from something like RHEL, for example. This was a system called Yggdrasil Linux / GNU / X, or Yggdrasil, or LGX for short. This was the first proper live CD distribution and described itself as a plug and play system configuring itself for your hardware. It would have X11 just automatically working. It certainly tried to do so, but this was offering things which at the time just were not really a thing from any of the other distros available at the time. Whilst everything it did could be done on other distros, the out-of-box experience truly was above everything else at the time. Now, the beta for this was sold at $60, which, especially for the 90s, was very, very expensive, with the full production release being $100. This distro remained in active circulation until about the year 2000, with the last corporate filing being in 2004. It was the first, but Yggdrasil was not the only distro of its kind. In 1999, we saw Coral Linux, which shipped the CDE, Common Desktop Environment, and attempted to emulate a Windows look and feel, much like what you get from something like Mint today. This was eventually bought by Zandros Linux, which began offering a Home Edition, Premium Edition, and Professional Edition. Now, I wonder what sort of model they were trying to replicate at the time. Now, Zandros actually stuck around for quite a while, ending in 2007, and at some point began offering a developer edition using DWM. So that came out sometime after 2006. So whilst they did have it, it wasn't a very long-running version. If you go and scroll through the Wayback Machine, you're gonna see them rename different versions and rebrand things, and I don't know what they were doing. They were just trying out different things, but the important thing is those editions they had weren't free. You would pay to get access to them. But when we talk about commercial offerings in Linux, it's not always just the commercial-only distros. It was fairly common for distros like Slackware, for example, to sell installation CDs as a way to additionally fund the project. Nowadays, you don't even see this. At best, you'll see maybe like a hidden donation link. There are some people on places like eBay and Amazon that are selling installation CDs, or in many cases, installation thumb drives, but these in none of the cases are endorsed directly by the Linux distro themselves. If they were, it would be advertised on the distro site. And I cannot forget, because I know someone is going to mention it, there were also magazines that came with a Linux install CD as well. There is a ton of people out there who the very first time they ever used Linux was on one of these magazines. But this is still a form of commercial selling of the CD, because you still had to buy the magazine, and there was some sort of deal with the distro and the magazine that allowed that to actually happen. Now, for a reason I'll get to in just a moment, I do think Ubuntu played a really big part in killing off all of this, the commercial distros, the magazines, buying distro CDs directly from a distro, but it is very much a two-part problem. The first part is, even up to the mid-2000s, it was still very common for people to be on dial-up or really slow DSL connections. And of course, there were many people at the time that didn't even have a home connection, and to get internet, they would have to go to like the library or their school or other things like that. And I know even today, there are still some regions like that, but it's a lot less common than it was back in 2005, 2006. As global internet speeds have been rising, requiring a full installation CD, or nowadays it would be an installation thumb drive, just isn't as necessary. However, during that period, we need to talk about the way that Ubuntu completely outpriced all of the other competition, to the point where nobody could compete with what Ubuntu was doing. So again, Ubuntu launched in 2004 with the 4.10 release, Warty Warthog, and if you go look at forums at the time, it released to a lot of fanfare because people knew it had a lot of backing, they knew it was going to have a lot of developers, they knew it was going to be this really big and really exciting thing that hopefully just made Linux considerably easier to use. It seemed like it was going to be a distro that really did make Linux plug and play, and in many ways, that is what Ubuntu did. Ubuntu, like Yggdrasil, really raised the bar for what it meant to be a Linux distro. Yes, there was still a place for things like Debian and Slackware, but for the less technical user, and obviously 2004, you still had to be a fairly technical user to use Linux, but it was now at a point where you could kind of get someone who is not a Linux user actually using Linux. But the year after that, this is where things really started to change, and this service is probably a big part of the reason why Ubuntu became the default Linux distro. This is a service called ShipIt. Request an Ubuntu CD. Ubuntu is available for download free of charge, because that's just a good thing to do. But if you have limited bandwidth and are unable to download it, we can send you a CD of the latest version. Remember, the delivery may take up to 10 weeks, so you might be better off downloading now. But if you only had a connection that you could get to this website and then request the CD, this was massive. No longer did you have to go and find a magazine that had a Linux CD in it. No longer did you have to go and pay a distro to get a CD. You could just go to the Ubuntu website and say, give me CD. Yeah, it's going to take some time. Sure, whatever. But how does anybody compete with that? You now have a system that you can get CDs entirely for free. And there wasn't a restriction of one CD per person or one CD per every certain amount of time. You could just keep requesting CDs, and it was being used as like a good faith system where you only request the CDs that you actually need. But now, outside of shipping restrictions, there was just a service here that you could just get Linux whenever you wanted. And as you probably guessed by the fact that it just doesn't exist today, eventually the service did come to an end. This was done in 2011 with the 11.04 release. We have shipped millions of CDs to every country in the world and brought Ubuntu into the lives of millions of individuals, we hope making them a little better. And you may have also guessed by the comment I made earlier about the fact that there weren't restrictions on how many CDs you could get. Whilst it was a free system, it was being funded by donations. And look, when you have a system like this, if there are less donations than there are CDs going out, you might end up in a situation where in 2009... they did have to bring in restrictions on how many you could ask for and how often you could ask for them, because there were some people who frankly were abusing the service, who were getting CDs that they just didn't need to get. They had a fast enough internet connection to go and download Ubuntu. They were requesting CDs way too often, and eventually all good things have to come to an end. Now, I know that today people like to meme on Ubuntu. Oh, snaps, they're so stupid. Why would anybody like snaps? Meh, what a weird time that was. The Ubuntu Edge phone, yeah, they did try to do that. And look, all of this stuff is fun, but it really was an important distro. And having the ship it model really made it difficult to compete with Ubuntu if you're in the market for getting a Linux CD, because now you not only had to compete with Ubuntu on making a better distro, which frankly, you probably didn't have the resources to do so. Now you had to outcompete them in price. You had to either offer it for free or give people a good enough reason that they would want to pay for it. Which, if I'm being honest, you probably weren't going to do, because you were not being bankrolled by Mark Shuttleworth, who sold Thought Consulting for $500 million, then formed HBD Venture Capital before Canonical. Like, Mark was already incredibly successful before Canonical even started. With all this being said, it should be incredibly clear how the commercial user distro just doesn't exist anymore. You didn't have infinite resources. You didn't have an incredible distro that revolutionized times. Other distros also kept getting better. That's the important thing. This is another reason why it's not entirely just Ubuntu. Distros like Fedora started to form. Distros based on Arch started to form. All of these other distros started to form around it, and because Ubuntu had completely killed off the ability to sell the distro and make money that way, they started forming around the idea of nobody's going to be paying for this anyway, so we need to find a way to make money in other means. If your System 76 selling hardware, if your other projects, donations, or sponsors, or other things like that. And then as internet speeds got faster and faster and faster, and these free distros were now available, why would somebody who has PopOS or EndeavorOS or Fedora or obviously Ubuntu, why would that regular person who's just a Linux desktop user ever want to go and pay for a distro directly? Why would somebody who has access to PopOS, OpenSUSE, Mint, Fedora, EndeavorOS, Arch Linux, if that's the direction you want to go, Debian, if you want to do that, Manjaro, and of course Ubuntu, why would that person ever pay for the distro directly? What is the value add? Maybe they'll buy individual pieces of software, maybe they'll donate to a software project, maybe they'll donate to a distro, but buying the distro? Well, there's all of these other free ones that exist. Why would I buy your distro? And let's say you do make a distro worth buying. Let's say it's some specially configured distro that works a certain way, things like that. Well, it's probably still using the software that every other distro has access to, so if you do something really crazy that's so much better, why wouldn't all of these other free distros do the exact same thing? We are now at a point where we have all of these really strong free distros that, even though the death might have been started by Ubuntu, because there is so much stuff out there that also competes in this space now, they also make it basically impossible for anybody to even try to compete in a commercial user distro. But let me know, do you think it is at all possible for a new distro to try and compete for the desktop user audience as a commercial distro? Yes, obviously in the enterprise space, again, that's very different, but for you and me as a desktop user, do you think it is possible? And if it is, what would they need to do? I would love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, Libero Pay linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and would you buy a commercial distro? What's this?